Everyone, I have with me today the woman who starred in the 1995 horror film by John Carpenter, Village the Damned. Please welcome Lindsey Haun. Lindsey, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing good. And I have to say again, it's a pleasure to meet you.
It's so nice to finally meet you. I'm sorry this took so long to put together.
Well, it's fine. I just want to say the right thing so you don't do that thing with your eyes and, you know.
Yes. I love that.
I guess my first question for you would be, how did you get into acting?
When I was 5 years old, my mom was working at the hotels in Los Angeles, and she was a bartender, and my dad was on tour, and I was at a preschool, and a friend of the family who worked for a children's agency had been pressuring my parents to make me a child actor. My parents didn't want to, and so then she just picked me up from preschool and took me to my first audition, and I booked it, and I loved it. And so that's basically how it happened. And then my parents were like, okay, you know, as long as you like this, I guess you can do it. And I loved it. So that's how.
How old were you when that happened?
I was 5.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
How did you become involved with this project? Like, how did it come into existence?
Well, I had a really good agent, and I was auditioning a lot. And by that time, I had already done a bunch of TV movies. I did a sci-fi, you know, made for sci-fi channel movie. And then I, you know, got a call from my agent. I was young, and I was tired of being the victim. And I had said, I prayed to God that he would make me a villain. I wanted to be a bad guy in a horror movie. And then my agents called with Village of the Damned, and it was like, I think it was like 8 pages of dialogue. And I was 8 and a half or 9. I know I was 9 when I did the movie, but I'm not sure when I was auditioning if I was 8. But I was so excited and I loved it. And so I worked my butt off, and there were so many auditions. They just kept calling us back and kept calling us back, and so many kids. And then there was one day when we were all invited over to, I guess it was John Carpenter's house. And there was a bunch of us kids, and they were mixing and matching us. And then they actually sent me home from that audition, which is funny. They were like, okay, they used to do this to child actors all the time, which I feel like is really rough. But it's sort of how when people audition for Broadway plays, how those auditions go. But they come out and they go, okay, these people can stay. And they just read your name, and then everybody else has to go home. And so they didn't read my name. And so my mom and I left. And then, right, and I was like crying. I was devastated. And I didn't really cry about anything at that point. Because I had been auditioning all the time, and I didn't get invested like that. But for this one, I was really invested. And then they called right when we got home, and they were like, wait, where'd you go? We need you back. Come back. We didn't mean to not read your name. And so then I came back, and then they made me Mara, and I was very happy. Very, very happy.
Did you have to use like a dialect coach or like some kind of speech therapy to do that monotone thing? Because it was almost like a monotone kind of thing, even though, yeah, like it was monotone but not quite, you know.
Yeah, well, my acting coach, who I had worked with his wife when I was younger, and then he took me on for those auditions, and I worked with both of them, but Sean Nelson and Don Jeffrey Nelson, they sort of crafted that character, really. And I worked with them a lot on that, and it was very intensive and very like And there were notes all over my scripts of, like, at what point to, you know, have a little bit of inflection, at what point not, you know, there, it was really hard. There were words I didn't know at that age, you know, and I had to learn basically, like, a new vocabulary and be very still, you know, and I'm like a kid, and it was a lot of work, and I do feel like it inspired a different kind of a work ethic for me than, especially at that time, than I saw most of my friends having.
You enjoyed doing that, didn't you? I could tell you really liked being Mara, didn't you?
I did. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. It was grueling, but I loved that. I loved it.
Yeah, I can tell, because by the end of the movie, I was thinking bad things about children. I was like, I have somebody just get her, blow her ass up, get her.
Get her.
Oh my goodness. My next question is, are you a fan of horror movies? And if so, which one is your favorite?
Oh my gosh, I love horror movies. Man, I have a lot of favorites. I love The Shining. The Shining has like major soft spot nostalgia in my heart. I love Poltergeist, which is a little bit more of a lighthearted horror movie, but it's so good. I really like Videodrome, Reanimator, and then like more recently, Suspiria was really cool. I really liked The Witch. I like really dark, weird horror movies. Oh, I loved It Follows. I loved that. I like when people take the horror film genre and then expand on it, you know what I mean, and do something artistic with it. Like, there are some images in The Witch that I still cannot get out of my mind that, like, freaked me out so much. Or, like, in Hereditary, did you see Hereditary?
I don't believe I have.
See it. It's more recent. It's with Toni Collette, but there's a couple of images in that movie that I'm just like, oh my god, I can't erase that from my brain. But
do you like any of the I'm sorry to interrupt, I wanted to ask if you liked any of the slashers, like the modern ones, like Freddy Krueger or Jason Voorhees or anybody like that?
I like them a little bit, but I'm slasher is a little rough for me because I've always been a little bit uncomfortable with just like the woman in a braless shirt running and screaming, you know what I mean, and then getting stabbed by like a phallic thing. Like, even when I was a kid, I was kind of sometimes that was a little too much for me. I liked things that were more like, I guess, supernatural, you know? Like, I loved The Thing. The Thing was what got me so excited about doing Village of the Damned, because I loved that movie as a kid.
Oh, the Thing, that movie creeped me out. It was so gross with the aliens and stuff. You know, I see what's going on here. I think I see what it is, Lindsey. I think you're so tired of the woman being oppressed that you want to, you know, get some type of revenge with
probably
this Village of the Damned. That's what it is.
That's right. Yeah, that sounds about right. That sounds pretty on brand.
I see what it is.
Yeah, I mean, I think I probably, you know, like, I really liked Teeth. That's kind of a slasher movie, but that's like the woman, her vagina has teeth, you know?
Oh, wow.
Did you ever see that?
No, I didn't. I don't think I want to see this.
Maybe we don't like the same thing.
You know, but I see what's going on. You got like a little revenge thing going on. I'm like,
I loved that. The Crow too, which is not a female revenge movie, but yeah, I guess I do like revenge movies. I guess you're right. Yeah. I like revenge and like supernatural and like justice movies or demonic. I like demonic movies, you know.
Well, but you know, something's telling me not to piss you off.
I like that you feel that way. That's good.
Yeah, I'm not gonna We're just going to go to the next question now. That's what we're going to do. My next question is, who's your favorite actor and why?
Oh, wow. Oh, man. I have a lot of favorite actors. One of my favorite actresses right now, oh, God, how do you say her name? She was in Maniac and in Crazy Rich Asians, which I wasn't, like, a big fan of that movie. I loved her in Maniac, and then I've seen her in other things. Her name is Sonoya. It starts with an M. Oh, my God, I'm Googling it right now. She's just this incredible, yeah, Sonoya Mizuno. It's not very, I'm a really big fan of her. She's amazing. I don't know her personally. She's just incredible, and I'm really loving her. But I really like people who have, like, an element of wildness to them. Like, I really like Michael Keaton, yeah. Jeff Goldblum, people who have, like, they're charming and fun, but then they also have this thing underneath that is, like, so alive and almost a little bit dangerous, you know?
Yeah, well, they seem like a lot of fun, so that makes sense.
Yeah, fun and a little dangerous, maybe. Mm-hmm. but, yeah, and of course, you know, like, everybody's going to say Meryl Streep, because holy crap all the time. Tilda Swinton, I love Tilda Swinton. Oh my gosh. Yeah, you know, all the greats. There's so many greats right now. I really love, what is his name? That guy, he's in Atlanta, the show Atlanta, and he was also in Get Out. Oh God, it starts with an L.
I'm trying to think of who you might be talking about.
Up right now, I love him. I mean, obviously, Donald Glover's great, but where is... Yeah, Lakeith Stanfield. He was also in, I think it's Stanfield. Lakeith Stanfield. He was also in... Oh, God, what was that movie? And see, this is just going to be me, like, nerding out with you and now looking things up because I don't remember
the name. Oh, that's... Look, listen, that's perfectly fine. I'm the same way. I had trouble pronouncing somebody's name from Twilight Zone this morning when I was reviewing it.
Oh, no.
This is perfectly fine. I want to let you know right now, when I was a child and I saw you on the screen, I spent a lot of time by myself because, you know, I have cerebral palsy. So the other kids were...
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah, they were playing outside, and so I would watch Village of the Damned over and over and over again. And I just want to say that this means so much to me because I'm getting to speak with the little girl that I watched over and over and over again, and I just absolutely love that movie.
Oh, you're going to make me cry.
Here's the thing. I'm just saying, I'm being real with you because... I was on such a roller coaster. It's like it was a mix of emotions between terror, and yet I liked you. I was like, she's so cool, you know?
Wow. Thank you. Thank you.
And I just want to say thank you for giving me this time, because time is the most precious thing you can give somebody. It's better than an autograph because time is the one thing that you cannot get back. And when you decide that you're going to give somebody your time, it's a beautiful thing because you can't get it back. And I want to say thank you. My family thanks you. Oh, and wow. we're so grateful to God, and we give all praises to him today, especially Absolutely. Me. Thank you so much.
How funny that's so sweet. I give all praises to him as well. I mean, I prayed for that movie to be in that movie. I prayed for that movie, and then it happened. So,
oh, definitely,
maybe there was some divine, divine intervention there. That's awesome.
Maybe so. And I hope I didn't embarrass you or make you feel uncomfortable. But I had
no. Oh my God, not at all. Uh-huh. Not. How could I be embarrassed by that? That is beautiful. I'm humbled by it, if anything.
Thank you so much. And I hope that even after this interview, I hope that somehow we'll come together and do something else. Who knows?
Yeah, I would love that. I would really love that. It was really lovely talking to you.
Definitely. My next question for you is, how did you prepare for the role of Mara? Did you do anything specific? Did you say to yourself, I'm gonna purposely be evil? Like, how did you do that?
I put myself, you know, at the time they had sort of, I don't know if this is exactly what they wanted the public to think, but the general idea was that Mara and all of the children were aliens, you know, and which I was really into aliens at the time, and so I was very excited. And so I just sort of put myself in the shoes of colonialism, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, of a being that thought it was higher than another being, of a being that thought it had the right and would do anything necessary to gain what it needed to gain for its species, you know? So it was, and I do think that that is kind of pure evil. Like, I think a lot of the evil that we see in the world is done from this, you know, place of trying to survive, or, you know what I mean? There's always this, like, us against them thing. And, mm-hmm. you know, we're all just kind of terrified beasts, you know, scratching at each other.
So is that what she wanted to do? Did she want to come to planet Earth and take over? Because I'm saying to myself, she has her own planet. Why does she need to come to our planet and
This is so cool. I've never talked about this with anybody, but the narrative in my head was that her planet was dying, and so they needed to find a new planet to colonize. And they were sort of the first, and they were more of a warring race, you know what I mean? They're not E.T., they're the other guys, you know, they're more like Klingon, right? And so, their idea is that you can't really negotiate, you have to take over. And so they were coming in to do a sort of guerrilla style, below the radar takeover for their people, to bring more of their people. And that was sort of my idea of what she wanted. So even though, like, she was emotionless, but that was more about, it was all like sort of grounded in this reality of, like, that's just what her species is, you know?
I'm telling you, you guys did great. John Carpenter did a great job.
Yeah.
I don't always like every single one of his movies, but this particular one, he did just fantastic. Because like I said, by the time the movie was over, I was ready to take the VHS and throw it against the wall. I'm telling you,
I love that.
Had tons of emotions, you know?
That's amazing.
I really don't like evil, like, at all, you know? And I know if you looked at my YouTube channel, it would look differently, but I don't like evil. Like, I like to see Michael Myers come back and do his thing, but then once it's over, I'm like, can you just get rid of him already, you know?
Yeah.
So,
definitely.
Yeah, it was the same thing with Mara.
Yeah, I love that. That's great. I think it's always scary when it's like, you know, I feel like that trend has been happening a lot in newer horror movies, that like the evil just stays, you know what I mean? That we're not really conquering it. And I do miss the conquering of the evil. I miss that a lot.
You are so much fun and I'm really enjoying this. I truly am.
Thank you. I'm enjoying this too. This is great. I get to talk about myself.
I had to go on YouTube and watch a video of you because I wanted to see what you were like now, you know? So I was like, I wonder what she's like, you know? Oh, and the thing is, you still have that look, you know? I can't describe it. It's a look. Like, you got the Mara look. I just...
That's great.
I turned on the YouTube video and I'm like, there it is.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. There's that. Which one? Which one did you watch? There's so many.
I don't remember, but I know you were standing up. It might have been like, it's something like a red carpet kind of thing, and you were talking to someone. I wish I could send you the link.
Oh, maybe it was me and RJ. Was my hair short? Like shoulder length? It might have been me and RJ. Anyway, it's not a big deal.
I can't remember, but all I know is you just looked exactly like her, but just older. It's like, if Mara was older, this is what she would look like.
Yeah.
That was great. It truly was.
That's so fun. My
next question for you is there anything or anyone that scares you?
We're going to get deep right now.
That's fine. I like that.
I think, you know, like I was saying before, I think the us versus them thing, that scares me more than anything, like, especially that happening in the world right now, you know, whatever side you lie on politically, like, even people who agree with my political views, when they start talking in us and them terms, it scares me a lot, because I feel like the real evil is sort of this accumulative thing that happens when a bunch of people get together and decide that, you know, somebody is, you can write someone off, or you can call, I think really calling individuals evil, you know what I mean, is the evil. Seeing people as monsters, I think, is the evil. I think the lack of compassion and empathy that we have for each other, and the lack of wanting to understand why people believe the things that they believe, rather than just condemning them for believing the things that they believe, I think that scares the crap out of me. Like, that's what I think is gonna end the world, you know, that's what's going to set off the final nuclear bomb, you know, that's what's going to allow a psychopath to gain control of, you know, that kind of a thing.
It's so funny that you say that, and I don't mean to interrupt, but I have to say, it's so funny that you say that, because everyone keeps talking about the end of the world. They keep saying, in so many words, they'll say something like, let me see if I can give you an example, like, somebody like Rod Serling, you know, from Twilight Zone, he'll say something like, man's greatest weapon is himself, you know?
Yeah.
And everybody keeps saying that, from Rod Serling to Arnold Schwarzenegger. So I just find it very interesting that you guys keep, you know, you Hollywood celebrities keep pointing out that it's going to be us that end up doing us in, you know?
Yeah, that's funny. I mean, I think that it's true. I mean, you know, it would be great if we were done in by some meteor, you know, because then at least we didn't do that. You know, it's more heartbreaking. The heartbreaking thing is us eating ourselves, which, you know, you see it every day. It's happening every day, and just in tiny ways, you know, like, politically right now, like, I'm not talking to some of my family members because we got into arguments on Facebook politically, which is, like, so sad, you know? And that's never happened before, you know? And so it's just a really strange time.
I have to say, and I'm trying to be as professional as I can, because I've done about 5 or 6 of these interviews, so this is a... I've been doing this for a while, and please excuse the unprofessionalism, but you are cool as hell. Like,
thanks. I don't know if that's unprofessional. It makes me feel real good.
you are the bomb, as they used to say in the 90s, you know?
Thank you.
You are awesome. You really are.
Thank you so much. That's so sweet.
My next question for you is, what was Christopher Reeve like? Because I know, you know, you guys were going back and forth on screen, and he did that little line at the end of the movie where he said, "You should feel! You should feel something!"
Yeah! He was amazing. He was really intense. You know, it was strange because up until that point, I was always doing roles where I was playing somebody's kid and I'd have to bond with them. but we specifically tried not to bond with each other, and we would, you know, catch ourselves joking around, and then he would stop, or, you know what I mean? Like, because we did actually enjoy each other, but we couldn't, you know, especially people working with kids, and especially now that I'm an adult actor, and I've worked with a few kids in my life as an adult, like playing their parent, you know, you are afraid of influencing their work by in between, you know, takes. So he, you know, by what you're doing in between takes. So we would catch ourselves and then he would, you know, stop and remove himself. And that was kind of a bummer for me because I was like, oh my God, like you're Superman. You know what I mean? Like I watched Superman and I loved it. But then afterwards he, and not that he was mean to me at all. It was just there. It was just that we were trying to keep a distance for our characters, you know?
Oh, I understand completely. As a matter of fact, I said, I would tell all my friends, I said, listen, I take movies very seriously, and I let everybody know. I let all my friends know that if you ever played Michael Myers in a Halloween film, which I'm sure by now you can tell I'm a huge Halloween fan, because I mentioned them like 75.
Yeah, yeah, I love
but
that.
But anyway, if they ever played Michael in a Halloween film, I'm done, because I don't want to be associated with anybody that plays somebody that evil, you know?
Yeah.
But yet still, I can be associated with somebody that's an evil supernatural creature from outer space, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, it is what it is.
It is what it is.
It is what it is. But my next question for you is, in the film, you played an evil alien. Well, at least that's what they have you listed as on Wikipedia. You're listed as an alien.
Great.
Do you believe that there's life beyond our planet?
I did, and I do. I've now started to, I'm not going to even be able to come up with the names. I think it's not the Faraday paradox, but it's something. There's something about, I've been hearing a theory that there's something about if there was life on another planet, they would have made contact by now, or they never will or something, so we will never, I don't know. I think that I want there to be life on other planets. That's
just, I don't.
You don't?
I don't, not at all.
You know, it's funny because I grew up very Christian, and I remember really loving aliens, but then being really scared if they ever were to exist, because I was like, then what does that mean for my relationship with God, my relationship with my religion that I loved, and Jesus that I honestly loved? Like, I wasn't forced to go to church, like, it's my own thing. And then when I realized, like, oh wait, like, God didn't just create the earth, like, he created everything, you know?
Exactly.
What I mean? And then I was like, oh, you know?
Exactly.
So
if there are extraterrestrials out there, God made them.
Yeah. Yeah. And I remember going, that's exciting, because I would love to see more.
I don't want there to be extraterrestrials, because I'm afraid they're going to be like you. I'm going to be like, oh, it's real.
I don't think that they will. I don't know. It's weird. I have no idea what extraterrestrials would be like. It's so fun to play with the idea, but the reality is that, like, we don't know how humanoid they're going to be. They're probably not going to be humanoid at all, you know? So weird.
I hope I don't have to find out.
Maybe they're just mushrooms. Like, maybe mushrooms are the aliens that have already come. You know?
Well, what if we were the aliens and they were the ones that are, you know, the rest of the people?
Yeah, I love that theory too. Like the original, like the whole idea around reptilians, right? Is that they're like they were here first, and then like we landed coming from another planet, like Mars or somewhere further off. I love that too. I remember I was at a camping trip, a Girl Scout camping trip, when I like was looking up at the stars, and I looked to my best friend, and I was like, "What if we are the aliens?"
Exactly. That's,
and
you
she
know,
was like, "What?" You know. I love that. I all of it. I would love. I definitely identify more as an alien on this planet than I do as a human. That's for
sure. Why you were so perfect for the role.
I guess so.
I'll tell you one thing, though. I would not want to go on a date with you, and not because you're not pretty or
that's
anything.
But fine.
Because if we were to go on a date and I said, I think I'll have the steak, and then you say, I think I'll have the chicken. I say, no, I want the steak, and then you do that thing with your eyes where you go, shh, I'm like, oh, I think we'll have the chicken, you know?
You know, I don't think you're far off. I think my husband might tell you that that is a very real thing. I bet he has a lot of stories that he could tell you about how much I'm like the real Mara.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. See, I knew there was something in there, you know?
No, but not with ordering, actually. I do have to say, this is a joke that we always have. My husband has a superpower. He orders so well. He's constantly like, I just ask him what he's ordering, because he just always orders the best thing, and I always want to eat his food. And then I do the eye thing, and he gives me his food.
Oh, see, there you go. Exactly. I understand his sentiments, believe me. Unfortunately, I'm down to my final question. Why do all good things have to come to an end?
Oh, I know.
If you could give advice to new actors and actresses, what would it be?
My advice would be to find what you really love about the art of it, not the celebrity of it, not the, you know, not the exciting parts, but the actual art of it, the actual nitty gritty of it. Really figure out and fine tune what you love before you go out there and start putting yourself out there and getting trained, because you don't want to be something that somebody else has crafted. You want to be your own instrument that then somebody helps you fine tune.
But I mean, let's be honest. You have to. There's a part of you that enjoys being famous, isn't there? I mean, don't you like when people ask you for autographs and things like that?
Oh, I'm not saying that that's not great. That's great. Obviously, everybody loves to feel great. But I'm saying, in order to really be a good actor, you need to remove, I mean, I'm not saying don't like that. I'm saying, yes, love that. That's so fun. I love it whenever anybody comes up to me, and especially at my level, because I'm not berated by it. You know, there was a time in my life when I couldn't like go to the bathroom without people looking under the stalls and things like that. And that was
okay,
too much.
You know what? That's just weird.
That was too much. I'm at a great level now where I'm just like out with my friends, and somebody comes up to me and says like, oh, that movie that you did, you know, really made an impact in my life, you know, and that's amazing. I love that. I love when people come up to me and talk to me.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, Village of the Damned definitely made an impact on my life.
And I love that.
I know not to piss you off, that's for sure.
Great. Oh, God, I'm so happy that sent a message out that people just want to be nice to me. That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
or any woman, for that matter. Because
yes! She might
look at me like that, and I might be, hey, do you know Lindsey Haun? You know her, don't you? Because you're doing that thing with your eyes that she does.
Yes, feminist represent.
Oh, Lindsey, I want to thank you for being here, and this was so much fun.
This was so fun. Thank you so much.
You're just so down to earth.
Oh, thanks.
And I really appreciate that, because I didn't know what to expect when I first sent out the email, and I want to thank the woman. What's her name? Allison.
Allison. Yeah.
Right. Is she your manager or something?
Yeah,
like?
She's my manager. Okay. Yeah, she had such a hard time wrangling me for this. I'm so sorry. I've been really distracted by a lot of work things and life things, but she kept hounding me about it. So definitely thank her, because she is the reason why this happened. I kept forgetting.
And I don't mean to look a gift horse in the mouth, but I know a lot of these celebrities, because I've reached out to so many. They don't do these interviews because, unfortunately, there's nothing to gain from it, you know, from them. So they don't like to do this. And one of the actresses that I reached out to, I'm not going to tell you who it is because you might know her.
Okay.
But anyway, I asked her manager, I said, you know, could I get her for an interview? And I told him in the email that she can promote anything that she may have, or, you know, any of her new content or whatever. And he basically said to me, well, we have nothing to promote, so no.
Yeah. Like,
well, that, you know, that's not, it's not very nice. I believe in helping people.
Yeah.
So I don't mean to look a gift horse in the mouth, but what made you agree to do this?
I think, you know, if I was at a point in my life where, I don't know, where I was getting hounded, you know, it might have been something where I was like, well, if I'm not promoting anything, like, I need to take a break, because it does get exhausting to do interview after interview. You know, I've gone through years of my life where that was happening all the time, and you do kind of have to be choosy, because you have to be, you have to guard your energy a little bit, you know. But right now, I do love talking about it, and I felt like, from the things that I had looked up about you, I felt like we were gonna have an interesting conversation, that you weren't gonna ask me all the same questions, you know, that I've already answered a billion times, and you seem like a real person, and that's also really attractive to me, because I, you know, you get interviewed by people who are just, they're not really listening to you. They're asking your questions, but they're not really listening to anything that you're saying, so it just feels like you're putting information into dead air, or like into the abyss, and that's more exhausting. Like, I like conversations, you know.
Yeah.
I like the give and take, and it seemed like you had that, and my manager seemed to think that too, so yeah,
I guess it was meant to be. And
yeah,
like I said before, I don't mean to get all preachy on you, but I'm not gonna hide who I am for anybody, and I have to say it again, all praises to the Most High, and I give him praise, because he put that humble spirit on you to, you know, to get you to come and do this, because so many people have said no to me. Well, if I can't get anything out of it, then no, you know. And yeah, I think that's really selfish, you know. I'm not saying you guys owe us anything, but I'm saying, is it like, what is it going to hurt for you to sit down and talk to somebody, and you could possibly change their day or change their life? You don't know what kind of impact you're having on that person. You could be one person that could get them off of drugs or what have you, just anything. So you know, don't just think about yourself, think about how you can help the next person. Because I used to be like that. I used to be concerned with just getting views on my channel, but not anymore. I want to see what I can do to help people, and I'm certainly glad that there are people out there like you that are, you know, down to do that. I really appreciate that. And I just want to say one more thing, and then I'll let you go.
No problem.
My mom said to me, because I talk a lot about civil rights, and she said to me, she said, son, you know, not everything is about race. It's about one thing. Some people care and some people don't. And it's that simple. And obviously, Lindsey, I'm talking to somebody who cares.
Oh, and that's sweet.
I really appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Of course. And, tell your mom I thank you too. Tell your mom I said hi.
Well, I will definitely tell her that you said hello, because see, that was her right there. She says hi.
She says hi. Did she just say hello? Amazing. I love that.
Yeah, she told me, she says, you know, some people care and some people don't. And her words just really touched me. And like I said, I'm talking to somebody who cares. And I just want to say one more time to the audience, you guys have been listening to actress Lindsey Haun from Village of the Damned. It was truly a pleasure having you on. And again, I give all praises to the Most High for sending you here to me.
Amen.
To, and thank you for that. I really appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Of course. Thank you so much. This was really wonderful. It was really great talking to you.
Thank you, Lindsey.
Have a great rest of your day.
Same to you. Bye.
Bye.